subject, and if and when emotions arise, just take a few deep breaths and imagine a place where you feel safe. We also know that it's hard, especially in this new world of virtual space. So feel free to turn your camera off if you need to, mute yourself. There's been several meetings where we've heard dogs barking and things like that. Don't get embarrassed. It's okay. We understand. But we would like to see your faces. So if you can have your camera on, that would be even more better. So our objectives today is to practice self-care and healing the body. We also want to get to know the FutureMakers Coalition. We want to explore structural racism through the lens of COVID-19. We will learn about our own implicit biases and ignite collective action and co-create anti-racist systems in Southwest Florida. It's also important to note that this is a brave space. So we acknowledge that inequity plays out in a variety of spaces like gender identity, sexuality, citizenship status, socioeconomic status, physical ability, etc. Today we are specifically focusing on race and ethnicity, but we will briefly touch on other inequities as well. We also need to understand that most of the things that you're going to hear will mention specific racial and ethnic groups. It's just important that we are respectful, even if you disagree with something, that you're open to changing your mind. You're also willing to share your thoughts. There'll be several times where you can interact via the chat box and try to understand other people's perspectives as well. So what is the FutureMakers Coalition? The FutureMakers Coalition is a collective impact initiative. So it's a network of people all across Southwest Florida working to achieve one goal. And that goal is 55% of working age adults in Southwest Florida with a degree or credential by 2025. So right now we're at about 41%. So as you can see, we have some ways to go to reach our goal. So the FutureMakers Coalition is working really hard and collaborating with others to help achieve that goal as well. So since the FutureMakers started in about 2014, 2013 being our base year, we have increased degrees and credentials past business as usual by almost 31,000. So that's a lot of people with degrees and certifications ever since the FutureMakers Coalition started. So that's something to be really proud of. But as you can see, we're not moving fast enough. So if we want to reach our goal, we have to do other things to help us make sure that everyone has equal opportunity in Southwest Florida. So as you can see, we have made progress, but the progress has been little, and we just need to push ourselves a little bit more so we can fully get to that 55% within the next 4 years. So our point of view is that everyone deserves access to equal opportunity. We also understand that opportunity is not equal. Policies, practices, and beliefs unfairly hold some students back. And we can make opportunity real by taking action to right the wrongs and achieve just and fair outcomes for all. And with that, I'd love to introduce Dr. Angela Corley. She has served as an advocate for students pursuing opportunities in post-secondary education for almost a decade. Dr. Corley earned her doctorate in educational leadership from the Florida State University College of Education in her hometown of Tallahassee, Florida. Additionally, she holds a Bachelor of Arts degree from Hampton University Scripps Howard School of Journalism and Communications and a master's degree in public administration from Northern Kentucky University. Prior to joining the Florida Gulf Coast University TRIO and Outreach Program staff, Dr. Corley worked for Florida A&M University, also known as FAMU, wherein she held positions with educational programs such as Upward Bound, College Reach Out Program, or CROP, and an Educational Talent Search. Although Dr. Corley has provided leadership for federal TRIO programs, as well as implemented numerous counseling sessions, workshops, instructional activities, college tours, and speaking engagements with TRIO participants and their families, she believes her biggest contribution has been her research. Dr. Corley's background with first-generation college students was an inspiration for her dissertation entitled Understanding the College Readiness Experience of Rural High School Students in Pursuit of Postsecondary Education. Prior to working in higher education, Dr. Corley spent several years serving as a public relations professional for the National Underground Railroad Freedom Center, which is a museum located in Cincinnati, Ohio. During her tenure at the Freedom Center, Dr. Corley was an integral part of the community engagement team, which helped to raise awareness for the $110 million capital campaign for the completion of this museum, which highlights the stories of heroic leaders from the Underground Railroad to inspire modern day freedom conductors. Dr. Corley's experiences at the Freedom Center helped spark her spirit of activism, which she uses today to connect TRIO students to opportunities in higher education. So without further ado, Dr. Corley, it's all yours.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Milena. First, I would like to thank all of the leaders at FutureMakers and for all of your hard work. It's amazing what you all are doing. I'm new to this area. I've just been here maybe about a year. And so I'm so excited to learn about your organization and all the wonderful work that you all are doing. I especially want to thank Tessa Lesage and Milena Mode and Kim Williams for spearheading this. This is wonderful. And I also want to thank my colleagues at Florida Gulf Coast University for recommending me for this opportunity. And so I think they're all on Jessica Homer and Emily Nana. Thank you all for that opportunity as well. Today, I want to talk to you about resiliency. The name of my presentation is You Can Do It, and it's an interactive discussion on the different characteristics that lead to resiliency for those who are seeking college and career opportunities during uncertain times. Next slide, sorry. And so I can't talk about resiliency without sharing my story, okay, and the different things that I went through that led to my ability to be resilient and as I continue to thrive and work on my resiliency. So I first want to start with my personal belief on higher education. I've worked in higher ed for about 10 years now. It's amazing. And so through my experience, I've just developed this personal belief that if given the opportunity, a person with the aptitude for college curriculum can achieve success despite the challenges of their race, gender identity, socioeconomic status, and background if they are self-determined and supported by a positive network of individuals. So I'm going to talk about that today. This picture of me was taken in 2018 at Florida State University as I was preparing to graduate with my doctorate degree. And this was a very proud moment for myself. And I just want to talk about how I got to this point. You know, there are not a lot of African-American women, not even a lot of women. We don't make up the majority of people who hold terminal degrees, whether it's PhD, EdD, medical degrees, and so on and so forth. So we're still a very small group of individuals that have accomplished this. And so I often like to share my story and how I got here because there may be someone else who's interested in pursuing that. And if they see me and they know that I was able to do it, then perhaps maybe they will step out and try it for themselves. And I wish them all the best and the most success in that. And so I just continue to share my story and my journey so that people understand that I'm not that much different from you, and I was able to do it. So now we'll move through, and I'm going to share a little bit about my background in higher ed and how I got to this point. Next slide, please. This is an image of young women who are graduating from college, and I thought of myself when I saw this. And to the left, I have the seal for Hampton University, which is my alma mater for my undergraduate degree, as Milena explained my background. And so Hampton University, let me tell you a little bit about Hampton. It is an HBCU, a historical Black college or university located in Hampton, Virginia. It is pretty well known amongst the HBCUs. It's up there with Spelman, Morehouse, FAMU, many others. And so Hampton has a very long, rich history. And at this institution, and it's a private institution, which is a little different from FAMU, which I'm going to talk about later. But during the time when I was a student at Hampton University, I had just been through a very traumatic experience prior to starting college. My mother had passed away from breast cancer. We lost her during my senior year in high school, and she was also my teacher. She was a high school teacher and all my friends loved her, and she was just an amazing person. And so losing her was a major void in my life. So although I was academically prepared for college, I still came to college with this issue, so to speak. And so when people are working in higher ed, you have to know that students show up with more than just their test scores, beyond just their academic accomplishments. And so they may need more support and help. And at that time, there were, you know, a few professors that extended themselves to me, and I had my friend group, but that was pretty much it. There was no organized effort to make sure that I made it through and that I continued, even though things were hard for me. And I also have to credit my family, my dad, my brother, and aunts and uncles and cousins who kept encouraging me, because again, I left Tallahassee, Florida and moved all the way to Virginia. So that was quite a transition in itself, but I made it through. I was resilient. Northern Kentucky University is my second alma mater, and I decided to go back to school as a professional working in Cincinnati, Ohio. And yes, this is Kentucky, but we know that Ohio and Kentucky are bordering states separated by the Ohio River. So it was a very short commute for me to go from my job, which was in downtown Cincinnati, to the classroom in the evenings is when I studied. And I did this in face-to-face format. There was no online program at that time. And so again, this was a huge transition from coming from an HBCU to a predominantly white institution. And again, I was the only African-American and woman in a lot of my classes because I was studying public administration. And many of the individuals who were my classmates were police chiefs, fire chiefs, EMTs, you know, they just had all this background in public positions. And some of them were very prominent, and they were, it was very interesting, put it that way, for me to be away from home again, Florida, and I'm in Kentucky, and I am surrounded by white men. And some of them really took to me, and we became friends, and it was wonderful, but some of them were not excited about having me in their class, and some professors were not excited. I only had two professors who really extended themselves to me. One was a white woman, and she was amazing, Dr. Oberding, and the other, Dr. Farmer. He was an African-American professor from Tallahassee. Actually, we didn't know each other until that time, but he was the only other person. And so again, the resiliency piece, it came, I think most of my resiliency came from my personal attitude about pursuing this. And I wasn't necessarily encouraged to stay in the program, but I did anyway. And so now I like to talk about Florida State University, which is near and dear to my heart. FSU is amazing. And I'm not just putting that little shameless plug in there, but my experience as a student, everyone was supportive, from my professors to my cohort members and, you know, beyond, just the community. And just everybody was watching, pushing, and hoping that I would complete this program. And so there were times where I wanted to give up. It was hard. It was a lot of work. I was balancing a full-time job, and I had this idea to go back and get a terminal degree at this stage in my life. What am I thinking? And so a lot of us were in similar situations. My classmates, some of them were married. We actually had a young lady who had a baby during the time, and we were like, what? And so we all pulled together and made each other accountable. And so therefore I had a very strong support system at Florida State University, and I was really determined. And so next slide. I'm going to now talk about examples of resiliency throughout my career. That was my experience in higher ed as a student, but I started my career at the National Underground Railroad Freedom Center, and it's located in Cincinnati, Ohio. It's a museum of conscience, and it was an amazing project to be affiliated with right out of college. I was selected for the Scripps Howard Internship Program, which is a national program. You all may have heard of Aquila and the Bee, the movie, and they featured the National Spelling Bee. Well, Scripps Howard puts that on, amongst other things. Scripps Howard is huge in terms of, they are a media conglomerate, HGTV, Food Network, many local news stations are Scripps stations. So it's a big deal for someone who's majoring in journalism and communication to get this opportunity. And actually, the woman who gave me the opportunity was from Kentucky. I met her husband. He had been an adjunct professor at Hampton University. And, you know, they were just wonderful people. And I became like their African-American daughter. You know, they took me in away from home. They had a farm down in Kentucky and they taught me horseback riding. Judy Klaibs and Mr. Klaibs, they were amazing. And so they gave me this opportunity to work as an intern, and they placed me at the Freedom Center. And while I was there, I learned about this, the mission to reveal stories of freedom's heroes from the era of the Underground Railroad to contemporary times, challenging and inspiring everyone to take courageous steps of freedom. That really spoke to me. I said, oh my gosh, I'm young, I'm right out of college, I'm ready to get involved. And so I wanted to use my degree, and I spent several years working in, you know, public relations. I was at one point in charge of publications and then community affairs. And so I'm featured here, and you can take the time to visit freedomcenter.org, which talks a little bit more about the exhibits and the programming there. But I featured this picture of Freedom Magazine. It was one of my favorite projects that I got a chance to work on. We developed a magazine to talk about stories not only from the Underground Railroad and the transatlantic slave trade, but tying that in with modern day freedom heroes, people who are actually working to stomp out some type of injustice. And so I got a chance to work and interview people and pull together different content. And so down here to the right, you see my little name listed there as publications coordinator. So it was a wonderful, amazing experience. And I just thought I would share that. And when we talk about resiliency, what better example than people who were enslaved, who were freedom seekers, individuals who decided to go against the times and say, I'm going to support this person. I'm going to provide refuge for them, even in a time when it is unpopular. And I could really risk my life and my family's life, but people came together from all walks of life, different races, different backgrounds, different regions, working towards this goal. And so I can't think of a better example of resiliency than the Underground Railroad and individuals who were able to survive slavery. Next slide, please. Also, I worked at Florida Agricultural and Mechanical University. Milena explained earlier that's pronounced FAMU. I know some people may not be familiar with FAMU, but it is a four-year institution. It's also a historical Black college or university, HBCU, and it is located in my hometown of Tallahassee, Florida. FAMU is an 1890 land-grant institution dedicated to the advancement of knowledge, resolution of complex issues, and empowerment of citizens and communities. I just want to focus on the fact that it's an 1890 land grant institution. I don't know how much people know about that, but there is something very significant, and I'll let you take the time to go research that. But I want to point out the fact that this is an institution that was established for the children of former slaves. So imagine, slavery was abolished 1865, 1890 comes FAMU, and other land grant institutions, other HBCUs started popping up to provide opportunities and education. Imagine being a student and your parents may have been enslaved. Just that's pretty heavy. Okay, so the mindset that you have the audacity to want to go and pursue a degree after coming, your family has never had anybody to provide that example of leadership for you, but you're going to take the initiative to go and pursue your degree on your own. That's what FAMU was rooted in, that story, that history of I'm taking this step, my personal step, beyond what's surrounding me and the whole world, all the negative things that could have been said about what you can and cannot do. You're taking it upon yourself to pursue your degree. And so I absolutely love my experience working at FAMU, working with the students at FAMU. They were amazing. I'm still in contact with many of them. As a matter of fact, just last week, I gave a recommendation to a young lady who I met during her freshman year, and now she's applying to graduate school, and she's like reaching out, hey, I need to get a letter of recommendation. I'm like, it's my pleasure. I've done that so many times for so many young people who are continuing to pursue their education. And I'm so proud of them, and I'm so proud of the work that I was able to do there under the Division of Student Affairs and working with federal TRIO programs. And I've also included their website here, famu.edu, if anybody is interested in applying there. I would be happy to talk with you about that in my experience. You may be trying to decide whether you want to attend an HBCU or a different traditional school. And so maybe I can provide some of my experience to help you make that decision. Also, I just want to point out, although FAMU is an HBCU, it's very diverse today. There are probably maybe more than 30% of the students there who are not African-American. So just to let you know, they're very diverse and they're welcoming of everyone, but there's that history is still there. And I think it's so important. Another reason why I love FAMU, just another personal plug about my story, is the fact that my parents, they were both first generation college students by the textbook definition, right? They were the first in their household to attend college and they decided to attend FAMU. They met, they got married and they started their family. So I love to joke and say, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for FAMU. So also another family tie, I have plenty of cousins who graduated also from FAMU, but I have a great aunt. Her name is Wilhelmina Jakes and she was a student at FAMU and she was instrumental in the Tallahassee bus boycott. She was a student. She was with her friend, Carrie Patterson, and this is 1956. And they were riding a bus and decided they didn't want to give up their seat. This is prior to Rosa Parks, didn't want to give up their seat. And so they were arrested. Two FAMU college students were arrested. And so local leaders, Reverend C.K. Steele and many others came to their aid and had to protect them, but it was very dangerous. And I was very close to my great aunt. She's passed away now, but I grew up listening to stories of her resilience, how even after she left FAMU, she had to leave FAMU. She couldn't graduate from FAMU. Her life was in danger. And so they were actually burning crosses on her front lawn as a student. Can you imagine? She's calling home to my great-grandmother, her mom, and rather than saying you can do it, she's saying you need to come home. You created a problem. So it wasn't something that was common or encouraged to speak out. And so she decided, you know what, I'm still going to pursue my degree, but she had to transfer to Bethune-Cookman College, which at the time was BC Bethune-Cookman College, but today is BCU, Bethune-Cookman University. And she was able to complete her degree there. And then after she graduated, she was an educator. It was years before she was able to find a very good job. She had a degree, but because she was involved in this quote unquote situation where she was a troublemaker, that's how she was framed as a troublemaker during those times. Now this is the 50s and the early 60s, but it was, you know, a community of people who gave her an opportunity. And ultimately she ended up working here in Fort Myers. And that's another reason why I love this area, because Fort Myers was the area that gave her an opportunity. So she came over here to teach school and then she got married and she was able to change her name. And that she talked about how clever that was. I'm sure she loved her husband. But the change of the name allowed her to pursue different job opportunities under a different name. So people didn't know that, oh, this is that student that was at FAMU that caused all those problems. Well, FAMU since acknowledged her, gave her an honorary degree. She's featured in the Black Archives, which is the museum at FAMU. She has a street, her and her classmate have a street named after them. And there's plenty of historic markers. There's a dedicated area for them. So it's just amazing, but she stuck with it. She was resilient and she kind of taught me how important it is to stand up for what you believe in, even if it's uncommon and unpopular, even if things get hard, even if your family doesn't understand why you did it, but you knew it was the right thing to do. And so again, all of that I attribute to FAMU. And that's why I really love Florida Agricultural Mechanical University. Next slide. Now, I am at Florida Gulf Coast University, FGCU. I'm very proud to have been here for a year now. It's been amazing. And I'm housed in the TRIO and Outreach Programs Department. We're under the Division of Student Success and Enrollment Management. And I currently serve as the project director for a federal TRIO program called Talent Search or Educational Talent Search, either one. And FGCU TRIO program, we target first generation college students. And we work with four schools in this area, Dunbar Middle School, Dunbar High School, Lehigh Acres Middle School and East Lee County High School, excuse me. Sorry, that's a lot. And so I've had the pleasure of getting to know those administrators and teachers at those schools, but I can't do this alone. I just want to recognize that we have two amazing coordinators, Dakendo Michelle and Darcy Dalzell, who work with the students at those schools. And they work very hard to provide counseling, academic support. They assist students with their college enrollment and finding financial aid and scholarships. We are often planning events. I know we're, due to the pandemic, we're limited to online events, but we have so many wonderful things that we're offering students, and including mentoring. So we have FGCU students who have mentored and worked with some of our pre-college students as they're preparing and wanting to know what the experience is like. So near peer mentoring is very big for us. Here's a picture of some of the activities where we took some students out to campus events, whether athletic or academic. And so if you are interested, you can find us on Instagram. I put it here, but I think it may be cut off. But we're at FGCU_talent search if you like to find out a little bit more about our activities. And if you're interested in joining, you can also find out from FGCU.edu and look up TRIO and outreach programs, and our contact information is there and an application to join. And later on during our break, I think I'm going to share a link for our YouTube presentation on our graduating seniors this year. We had over 100 students that graduated, and we featured some of them in this video. And so they were so resilient, another example of resiliency. Due to the pandemic, they were not able to have their traditional graduation ceremonies and activities, but they persevered, and many of them are continuing to follow through with their plans to go to college, and we're here for them. We've been trying to support them over the summer. We know this is something that can definitely impact your plans for the future. Next slide. Thank you. Now, for today's agenda, I talked a little bit about myself, and I love to provide that information so people know what perspective I have on the topic or the issue or my background. Today's agenda, I hope that we will discuss the current challenges for those who are seeking college and career goals. Those challenges being COVID-19, the pandemic, or any racial discrimination or disparities that may be taking place, and that we're paying attention to that. Also, I'd like to discuss my research related to resiliency and how to build certain skills in order to become more resilient as a student, and also to maybe inspire those who are educators and working with students, and things that they need to consider when working with students. Also, explore strategies to assist college and career seekers in being more resilient, and gather your feedback. I have a brief assessment that I would like for you all to take during your time with me today, and then we're going to talk about that. Over to the right, I have a quote from the late Congressman John Lewis. Never ever be afraid to make some noise and get in trouble, necessary trouble. I love this. I miss him. When I was working at the Freedom Center, we honored him. He received our International Freedom Conductor Award. He's amazing. I really look up to him, and I'm inspired by his story, how he was able to risk his life for what he believed in, and he spent his entire career working towards that. So I have him here today. Hopefully he'll be a part of our discussion, looking down on us and just proud that we're all still trying to continue his legacy and talk about those things that are hard to talk about, and being willing to break out and try to make a difference. Next slide. Okay, so I have a few things here I wanted to share to give us some context around how COVID-19 pandemic may be impacting college enrollment. So I went to the National Student Clearinghouse Research Center, and they are tracking this information. And on June 30th, they provided a report on the current term enrollment estimates. This is pre-pandemic. So this included April and May. And so if you want to find it, it's available. Provided the link here, and I also included it in the references. But one thing to point out, they said that overall numbers of students dropping to part-time, withdrawing, taking leaves of absence, and other status changes remained unchanged from pre-pandemic levels of 2018 and 2019. However, the data is starting to reveal that there is an emergence of small but concerning racial ethnic patterns, as African Americans and Hispanic students taking leaves of absence have increased fastest amongst all groups. This is very important to keep in mind. remember I talked about my story. And when a student shows up, there's so many other things that could be a threat to their ability to complete college. And so the pandemic, people may say, oh, well, you know, they had a chance to go home. They can study remotely, but you don't know what their home environment is like. You don't know what could be preventing them. And so we're starting to see this pattern here. And so we need to kind of track that to find out how we can be of assistance to these students that we may be potentially about to lose in terms of their college enrollment, and how the pandemic will impact future college enrollment decisions. So we have seen, just amongst even our FGCU Trio Talent Search students who just recently graduated, some of them are changing their plans. Whether they wanted to go out of state and now they want to stay closer to home, these are times where people are kind of buckling down. They don't want to take many risks, but we still don't need to. We need to be smart and safe, but we don't need to let this pandemic keep you from reaching your goals. So just have to be strategic in how you make these decisions. You don't just drop out, but we're going to continue to talk about that. Next slide, please. And also, let's think about what impact will COVID-19 have on the workforce? And in turn, how does that impact career preparation? So I went to the U.S. Department of Labor, and here's some things that I thought might be interesting. The unemployment rate declined by 2.2 percentage points to 11.1% in June, and the number of unemployed persons fell by 3.2 million to 17.8 million. Although unemployment fell in May and June, the jobless rate and the number of unemployed are up by 7.6 percentage points and 12 million. Okay. Among major worker groups, the unemployment rates declined in June for adult men to 10.2%, adult women 11.2%, teenagers 23.2%, whites 10.1%, blacks 15.4%, Hispanics 14.5%. The jobless rates for Asians is 13.8%, changed little over the month. Okay, so let's look at the teenagers. This is the age group for those individuals who may be trying to pursue college and they're thinking about, okay, should I work? Am I dropping out of school to work? But are there any opportunities right now? Probably not. And so some people may even get it in their mind that, why do I need to pursue an education when I can't find employment? And this is a real issue. They're going to keep track of these numbers, and the next employment update is due in August 7th. And so we'll find out a little bit more about if these numbers are going up or down, but we see who's at risk: teenagers, African-Americans or blacks, and Hispanics. We see that, that's in the numbers. And so I think we already know this, but I just wanted to provide this data for you to think about as we continue the discussion. Next slide, please. Okay, so I'm just gonna ask, I'm assuming everyone has heard of the CARES Act, Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security. I just wanted to point out the CARES Act is established to help all of us, but specifically how it's impacting students, those who are currently enrolled in higher ed, some of those same students that I've talked about earlier who may be dropping out of school right now. So initially when COVID-19 hit, a lot of provisions were made to allow students to stay connected and make things easier. They had an option to, I know at FGCU, they had an option to go home, collect the money or refund for their housing. That was probably very helpful to a lot of students if they were working with work study positions. They were able to still get paid even though they're not able to work physically, they still collected a paycheck. This is all very good, very helpful. There's some provisions that are made for students who are on financial aid, and that's good. And if you are a student and you didn't know that you could get some of this, please contact your financial aid department or reach out to one of us and we'll be able to connect you to someone, because there is money for you. Don't miss out on that. But it's more than just money, right? We talked about other things that are going on. So here's some other issues that the CARES Act may not even deal with. It's just not going to help you if you have personal obligations. And even though there may be you may be able to still continue financially to pay for college, but what if you have other personal obligations that still prevent you from doing that? Our mental health, you know, this is heavy on everybody right now. There's no cookie cutter reaction to how to deal with the mental health issues that have come out of COVID-19. We're all still learning how this is impacting us and family and friends, our local communities issues, unemployment or being underemployed, racial discrimination and bias. The anti-racism protests and things that are happening, this racial unrest right now. So there's so many things that could be impacting our students and their ability to continue. So I want to ask the group right now, I've listed some things that I thought might be an issue, but can somebody else, if you all wouldn't mind chatting or putting something in the chat, tell me what you think might be some issues. I could be missing something. And I think we have some students on here. I know one young lady sent me a private message stating that she's planning to attend FGCU in the fall. I'm very happy to hear that. And so please tell me, has the COVID-19 pandemic impacted your decisions for college enrollment? What's going on? I just want to know. Can somebody please share? Okay. Nobody wants to share how has the pandemic impacted you in any way as a college student. Do we have any college students on? I just know we have one because she introduced herself to me. Any other college students? Oh, hi. Okay. Is it Michaela? Hi, Michaela. Would you mind unmuting yourself and tell us where you're enrolled and what's your major?
So I go to Florida Southwestern, FSW, and my major is communications.
Very good. Similar to me. Okay. Journalism, communications. Michaela, have you experienced any setbacks due to COVID-19, and how has that impacted your ability to be a successful student right now?
So I was actually living on the dorms. So because of COVID, they had to make us leave. So I had to leave my dorms. So now I'm gonna be at home. And of course, all the classes are online. So I'm gonna be at home all day doing classes online now.
Okay, and so how has it been easy for you to stay focused and keep a schedule and, you know, stay encouraged through this time? Or do you sometimes find it difficult to complete your assignments online?
Yeah, it's been difficult recently. Our family had something happen, so it was.
Yeah. And so thank you for sharing that. So you just basically put some more context around the fact that this CARES Act is not going to resolve all of those issues. And so that's why we're here today to talk about resiliency, because we know what it's like to be faced with those challenges, and it's how you deal with that in order to continue with your educational plans. And so that's what we're gonna talk about a little bit more. Thank you for sharing, Michaela. Next slide, please. Okay, so I have this image here. Just, you know, I don't know these individuals. I hope this is a stock photo. I hope they don't mind, but I thought that they represented the two mindsets very well. On the left, we have the victim mindset. Nothing against, she's a lovely young lady. I don't know if she's sad or deep in thought, but I just thought that would be good to describe our victim mindset versus our creator mindset. The young lady on the right, she's surrounded by her friends. She seems happy. She's positive. And that's kind of like what we should all strive for, right? And so at FGCU and many other institutions, they have courses to help students in their transition to college. And so I actually teach one of the classes, SLS 1101. And one of the things we talk about is the victim mindset versus the creator mindset. The victim mindset is someone who is often overwhelmed by problems. They're stuck there. They can't move past it. They just constantly complain. And Michaela, you may have some friends who are like this. They just can't seem to get past it. They're always complaining, they're never moving forward. And the creator mindset may have the same challenges, the same problems, but they are positive about their approach to fixing the problem. Recently, I I spoke with my brother. I have an older brother, and we were reflecting on our mom. And so we sometimes like to tell little funny stories. And he was saying, yeah, I remember one time I was really going through it and I was, you know, upset and I didn't want to do anything. And I was telling mom, and she said, okay, so now what are you going to do? You know, and so that was our mom. That was her in true fashion. We would have moments where we would just want to give up, or, oh, this person didn't treat me right, or I just don't want to do it anymore. And she'd say, so now what are you going to do? You know, she just would not let us just have this victim mindset. It was, now you need to start thinking about how to fix your problem. So I want to ask the group, when faced with challenges, what mindset do you all have? Does anybody want to share? Or do you tend to be the victim or the creator? We're not going to judge. No judgment here. Anybody? How about another student? Is there another student on? Oh, thank you. Is that Maxim Farewell? Says, I try to be a creator. That's wonderful. Can you share an example of when you were a creator? And what was your challenge and how did you handle that? Did I pronounce it right? Is it Maxim?
Can you hear me?
Yes, hi.
Okay, yeah, you pronounced my name right. I suppose I'd have to think of a specific challenge, but I tend to take the problem head on, and instead of thinking, oh, like, woe is me, so to say, I try to explore all of the options I have at the time and say, okay, well, I can go with this option, and I know that if I continue on that route, I can overcome that challenge that was presented to me.
Wonderful. Now, did you come up with that yourself? Is that just who you are as a person, or were you taught that strategy?
I think it's both. Like, my family, we come from a lower socioeconomic status, so we have to, like, they rely on me to an extent to help them. So, and through schooling and education, my teachers and such, they really pushed me to not just sit idly by and let the opportunity pass me, but to just take it and continue to work towards my goals. I'm sorry, on the spot, I like can't think.
No, that was an excellent example, and thank you for sharing about your family and how, you know, you've gotten to be more of a creator in how you approach things. And I think that's amazing. I think that you're not alone. Many of the students who I've worked with do have very strong responsibilities, big responsibilities right now, and their family members are depending on them. So you're not alone. And I'm so glad that you're a creator and that you found a way to start working, you know, having a positive attitude to working through your problems, because we all have challenges. We all have problems. It's just about how we approach them. And so congratulations to you, Maxim. You're on the right path. Thank you for sharing. Next slide, please. Now I want to talk a little bit about my research. This is an overview of my dissertation. It was called Understanding the College Readiness Experiences of Rural High School Students in Pursuit of Post-Secondary Education. An overview, really quick, the purpose of the study was to understand the skills, knowledge, and attitudes of rural high school students in their preparation for college enrollment. Framed by resiliency theory, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about these resiliencies, but the framework for the study was resiliency theory and academic resiliency. This was a mixed study, both quantitative and qualitative methods were used, and there were 50 participants overall who participated, and these were all 12th grade students who were about to graduate from their rural high school. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the data that was collected, but there was a survey that I developed, and it was focused on college readiness and protective factors, and looking at what are the protective factors that students have that make them successful. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. And then ultimately, out of those 50 participants who took this assessment, I asked if anybody was interested in participating in a focus group. And as a result, there were three groups that emerged. a group of trio participants, people. And the interesting thing about this research setting is that there were actually three trio programs providing services all in one school. And that's usually, is very uncommon. Usually you have one trio program serving one particular audience. But we had, at that time, they had three different programs. And so I was really interested in seeing how effective were these programs in helping the students prepare for college. So I looked at those participants who were only in trio. Then I had a group of people who were not in trio. And then as a result, I realized that all the students weren't on the same academic level. And so the non-trio students and dual enrollment participants, they kind of emerged into their own group. And I wanted to look a little bit closer at the students who were the academic leaders and what skills did they have that may be different from people who didn't have high GPAs or high test scores and weren't dual enrolled and didn't have trio as a support, but some kind of way they were still pursuing this. And so I was really interested in finding out about these three different groups. And so those are the three focus groups. I'm going to talk a little bit more about their resiliency and their scores that they had during the experience. Next slide, please. This is a story I want to share with you. And this was kind of the inspiration for my dissertation. I had already been working with many students prior to deciding to go back to school to find out how I could be more helpful. And so in my dissertation, I share this story. I talk about a student named Scotty. And again, everyone who I'm going to provide some information on, these are all pseudonyms, meaning I gave them a fictitious name. So this is not his real name. This is not his real picture, but this is his story. Okay. So I'm going to read it for you. Scotty was a student I met at Promised Land High School a few years ago. In the short interactions I had with him, I was able to ascertain his college readiness was at risk. First, he was behind by applying for college towards the end of his senior year. His ACT scores were low. Lastly, Scotty also carried the heavy burden of helping his single mother provide for his 11 brothers and sisters. Despite all of this, he was still accepted into a four-year college under a conditional status. He had only one semester to prove himself, but he was unsuccessful. Scotty had made the personal decision to give his mother his financial aid money instead of purchasing his textbooks, which resulted in his failure in two classes. If only Scotty would have developed the non-cognitive skills for protective factors that were necessary for survival in college. I asked myself, where was he supposed to attain these skills? At home? Perhaps if he had joined a trio program in high school, would things have been different? What if his high school had promoted a college readiness culture, or if at least one strong support person had made themselves available to him early on? Who was really responsible for Scotty's situation? Now I'm gonna ask the group, can anyone relate to Scotty's dilemma in any way, whether you're an educator who's worked with similar students with a similar story, or if you've often found yourself in challenging situations where you actually have to decide between survival, providing for your family, or putting your education first? Have you ever been put in that kind of dilemma, or have known anybody in that kind of dilemma? Does anybody want to share? I love stories, by the way. That's my journalism background. I'm not just nosy. I really enjoy hearing the stories because I think we can all learn from that. Does anybody want to share? We've heard from two students. Anyone else who hasn't had a chance to share yet? Okay.
I can tell a story if you'd like, Angela.
Yes. Hi, Jess. How are you?
Good.
Good to see ya.
You too. So I, you know, you and I have shared before that I grew up in a family that was like very dependent on me work-wise. And you know, when Angela and I were originally talking, Dr. Porley and I were originally talking about this presentation, we talked about how, yeah, now that I think about it, if I had stayed home to do online work, my family would have made me work and like pay bills towards the household instead. But I actually, this like, and it took a long time for me to get out of that cycle because I went to law school with like this dream of going to law school, and law school is expensive. And I lived in Massachusetts, so there was no way that I was going to stay there because I couldn't have afforded that. So I went to Kentucky. And there were plenty of times that I was like, I'm just going to borrow people's textbooks and eat peanut butter for a month. And it becomes really, and it was very straining. And I know that I would have done better if I had a better support system and was more set up to go into law school. I would have had better grades because a lot of me was like this kind of scrambling to make it work instead of like being able to just try, right? And being able to just focus my energy on school. So I very much identify with that story.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing your story with everyone. I know we did have our own personal conversation, and I think you're an amazing person. I think that the work that you're doing to help so many students, you set a wonderful example at FGCU. And, you know, I'm so proud of you because I know that, and I get a little emotional because I know that sometimes it comes down to just that one moment in time that could change the rest of your life. And so I'm so glad that you were, you push through that, and thank you for sharing that because that's an example, because I think a lot of times students don't even understand that everybody else is having a similar situation. You feel like you're all alone, and so we do have to share more, and that's really why I'm interested in this research. You know, Jess, you mentioned that there wasn't a system in place, right, for students who might be going through that. Now, I experienced the same thing early on in my educational journey as well. And so I think that it's amazing that colleges and universities are really looking at this more and developing programs and services to help all types of students going through many different experiences. So thank you for sharing that. And that's perfect. And I'm probably going to refer back to your story as we continue to have this conversation. Thank you. Next slide, please. Okay, I just want to quickly just talk about the framework that I used when I approached this study. On the left, you'll see a model here. It's the Glennie Richards meta theory model, and it's often used in assessing resiliency in youth and their ability to deal with mental health issues. But I like the model in that it showed this area at the top. If you look on the right, this is my version of it. That I used, and I only wanted to focus on learning about the protective factors, which I define as demographic characteristics, skills, and knowledge that students have, and then how do these factors help them when they experience some type of a disruption in their college enrollment. And so that's how I applied this model for my dissertation. Next slide, please. I also used the academic resilience and characteristics triad. This is something you can find out. I've included references at the end of this presentation, so if anybody wants to go and look up these books and things. But Morales and Trotman developed this triad, which I absolutely love, and it shows how a student's academic resilience is protected. If you look here in the center, this represents the student and their ability to be resilient academically. Even though there may be disruptions here to the left, the things that protect them are their personal disposition, their family, and their environment. These are things that could, if a student is acting at their best or the highest level in academics, more than likely they have these three areas working together. Sometimes you may only have your personal disposition, and you just survive, you make it, because maybe your family isn't on board with you. Maybe they've never gone to college and they don't understand the sacrifices that you have to make as a student. I remember when I was in college, one of my really good friends, she was an engineering major, which was huge for her as an African-American woman. And we were friends in high school. And although I was in Virginia, she was back in Tallahassee studying at the FAMU, FSU College of Engineering. And she would talk to me, we'd call each other and vent to each other. And I remember she was saying one night that because her parents, they didn't go to college, and she was one semester, she had to move back home, and she needed to pull an all-nighter. She needed to study all night long. And her mom just didn't understand, turn off the light, go to bed. I don't understand this. Why are you up all night? She's like, Mom, I'm going to fail my test tomorrow if I don't do this. I have to do this. And so sometimes your family, they just don't even understand what it really takes to be a student and to be successful. And so she had to, of course, and she graduated, I'm so proud of her. And now she's an educator as well in the STEM field. But, you know, I just feel like, you know, that is an example of how your family, even though they love you, they think they're doing the best thing. Her mom felt like, you need your rest. But she's like, no, I have to push through. So that's an example of how family could be an impediment at some point. And then your environment. And in the study, the environment consisted of the school leaders, your teachers, and everything. So let me go to the next slide, please. This is a little bit of an overview of the personal characteristics that students need. And just, I just want to hit the quick points. The literature says students who possess interpersonal and social skills are more successful. College requires certain skills such as working well with others, interacting with faculty and staff, and feeling comfortable around diverse groups of people. And non-cognitive skills can make the difference in whether a student persists in college or drops out, regardless of their intellect and academic competencies. Next slide, please. Family. The parental and familial relationships. The literature says first-generation college students, meaning the first in their immediate household to attend a four-year institution, face a unique set of challenges in college. Parents who attend a college or university have positive effects on their children's college readiness experiences, and the parental figures typically transfer their educational beliefs onto their children to create a continuation of education in the family. Positive parental involvement can enhance a student's understanding of college readiness. However, children from first-generation households may not always experience parental involvement in this way if their parents have never attended college. Next slide. The environment. The literature says a study found that talking to teachers and counselors had strong relationships with social and academic adjustment, as well as with positive attitudes for all students. This is important. Students need to learn to talk to their teachers, and information shows that students find it hard to talk to adults. This is significant because first-generation students spend the least amount of time of any group talking to teachers outside of class, and this is important. Participants in the study believe that discussions with high school staff positively relate to first-generation students adjusting academically. Next slide, please. I recommend Beyond the Big Test if anybody's interested in creating their own assessment around this issue. And I used Dr. William Sedlicek's book as a guide. And I developed my survey based on these 8 non-cognitive variables that he recommends to look at when you're talking about a student's resiliency. Positive self-concept or confidence, realistic self-appraisal, understands and deals with racism, prefers long-range goals to short-term or immediate needs, availability of a strong support person, successful leadership experience, demonstrated community service, and knowledge acquired in a field. Next slide, please. So based on that, the 50 participants, as you can see, this is a list of all of their scores in those individual areas. And for the group of 50 individuals who took the assessment, positive self-concept was at the top. And at the bottom, they had very low scores in successful leadership and knowledge of different professions. Next slide, please. And so these are the scores of those individuals in those 3 different focus groups. I even pulled out their scores to kind of get a better look. And so for the TRIO students, again, positive, they felt their area was the strong support system. And I'm not surprised by that they scored so high in that area, because of course, that's what TRIO does. We provide support. But also the non-TRIO students had a similar type of support, but those who were in the non-TRIO dual enrollment areas scored the highest, and they actually scored the highest amongst all different categories. And so if you're interested, I can provide more information about the study, but just to show you the differences in their experiences. Next slide, please. I want to build upon this study, and I'm interested in conducting a similar study, but in a different research setting. I want to point out that the participants in this study were predominantly Black or African American. As you can see, 83.33% who participated in the survey in my dissertation were African American. The setting was an African American school. So I would like to look at a school that may be in a rural setting, but that's not predominantly Black, maybe predominantly white, to kind of see if white or Hispanic students are more resilient or somehow in a way more prepared than the ones who I had a chance to talk with before. Next slide, please. And building on that, I also want to look at the household. So the students in my study, 50%, it was pretty almost even, but 50% of them came from two-parent households. So that's, again, looking at the stereotype is that many African-American students come from a single-parent household. Well, you had many who were coming from two-parent households. Next slide, please. And also their educational attainment of their parents. So majority of the students in this study, their parents only had a high school diploma or no high school diploma at all. So again, looking at whether or not it makes a difference, the student's parents' educational attainment in the next study, just to build upon this research, that's something that I'm interested in. Now I'd like to take a moment to allow you all to take a brief survey. It's very quick, especially for the students, but I've kind of designed it in a way that if any of the educators would like to take it as well. And this, it'll give you a score at the end and kind of give you an idea of where you are in terms of your resiliency. So we'll take a brief moment to do that. And I think the link to the survey has been shared in the chat. Thank you, Milena. And we'll take a quick break just to do that.
Was it too much time alone? Was it too tired to fall in love again? So I found us in a black room. Half moon silhouettes, drawn curtains from the rest of these memories. I forget sometimes, you forget sometimes.
Together, I'm going to pick up where we left off. So thank you for taking a few minutes to answer the questions in the assessment, and I'm sure you were given a score at the end, and we could talk a little bit about the questions and the scoring. But first, we have a question from Maxim, and I just wanted to bring that. I thought that Maxim asked a great question in the chat. He says, Dr. Corley, can we view the triad structure as being ideal, but that students can still can be academically resilient if one or multiple of the characteristics, whether disposition, environment, family, are weakened or perhaps absent altogether? Absolutely, Maxim. Yes, you can view it that way. It's ideal, and we understand that for most students, that's not the case, that they have all three working together in tandem, but that's our goal. And especially as educators and people who work in the role that I have, trying to assist students, we need to always be mindful of that. And so if there's any way we can be helpful to helping them strengthen their personal disposition, that's why we provide curriculum and things to help them with their self-esteem. We promote health and wellness, just being a well-rounded student and as an individual. And then in the local schools, you see there's a lot around parental involvement. I think this is why our state, the state of Florida, has made it a mandate for school districts to have some type of parental involvement component, because they understand that the family is important in the student's success. And so educators need to keep that in mind and try to engage parents at all times if you can. Also, the environment, keeping track of what you're doing in your environment, whether you're a school administrator, a teacher in your classroom, what have you, how is the environment being supportive to the student, and keeping that in mind as well. So thank you for raising that question. I thought it was a great question. So I hope I've answered you, okay. Now we will move on to looking at the actual questions. Just take a moment. The first question dealt with positive self-concept or confidence. The question reads, when I believe strongly in something, I act on it. Sorry, I was reading the chat at the same time. So the answer choices were strongly agree, agree, neutral, disagree, or strongly disagree. And so in this example, if you agree with this, you likely are more resilient because you are a person that takes action, right? And so many students, believe it or not, do not take action. If they believe in something, they sometimes people complain about an issue. When we talked about the victim mindset, is to complain and never act or do anything. A creator is someone who will take action. And so this question kind of gets to that point. Next slide, please. Realistic self-appraisal. That's what the second question focused on. And the question was, or the statement, I'm sorry, let me just make it clear. It's whether or not you agree or disagree with the statement. It's not an actual question. The statement is, I am confident in everything that I do, and there's not much that impresses me. I see this often with students who have this unrealistic self-appraisal of what they're capable of doing. Sometimes if you don't even understand the requirements, how can you meet them? If you think it's easy and simple, oh, they're just giving out college degrees. And so that if I just show up, I'm going to get a college degree. That's not being realistic. And so to say that you're confident and nothing impresses you, that basically means that nobody can tell you anything and nobody can make recommendations. And so we all, even as professionals, have to have a realistic self-appraisal of what we can do, what we need, how we can receive help. If we don't even think we need help, we're not likely not going to ask for it, right? Next question, please. Understands and deals with racism. This question, the statement, I'm sorry, asks, it says, my friends are exclusively the same race as I am. And it asks that whether you agree, strongly agree, if you're neutral on this, if you disagree, or if you strongly disagree. Now, I would like to ask the group very quickly if anybody would like to share how they answered that particular question. Or, I'm sorry, how, if they agree with the statement or not.
If I could.
Okay, hi, Sarah.
Hi, yes. So I'm just gonna introduce myself first. My name's Sarah. I'm enrolled at Nova Southeastern University in Fort Lauderdale. Wow. And I'm gonna be studying marine biology.
Congrats.
I answered this, I disagree. So I'm originally from Minnesota. I've never really cared much what race my friends were. As long as I connected with them, as long as we got along, you know, that was really my thing. My best friend, who I call my sister, she was born in Cuba. And she is just amazing. And we're just so much alike, you know, we have so much in common. Another one of my friends is from Ukraine. So a lot of my friends weren't even born in the US. Where I grew up in Minnesota, there was a lot of different people as well. I still have friends who are Asian, and much like that. And I do have friends who are the same race as me, white. And I do get along with them very well, but I tend to get along more with my best friend and some people who are more foreign.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah, for sharing that. I'm getting chills because that was the perfect answer. That's ideally what we're looking for. So you're likely, you scored very high on that question if you said you strongly disagree. And that's ideal. We want people to make friends and connections, build relationships with people who are different from us and in terms of our race and other areas as well. So thank you for sharing. That was wonderful. That was perfect. Next slide, please. Prefers long-range goals to short-term I'm sorry, short-term and immediate needs. So this was the next section that we looked at. The statements is what, I know what I want to be doing 10 years from now. And so we're asking whether you agree, disagree, or whatnot. So again, being able to look at the future, many of our students don't have that luxury. They're dealing with things right in front of them. I need to pay my phone bill. My phone is gonna get cut off. I need to help my mom. My little brothers and sisters aren't eating this week. My mom, she lost her job. I gotta do something. And it's really easy to say, oh, get a college degree. But if you have these challenges, you may not be able to stay the course if you're dealing with short-term immediate needs versus looking out into the future that, hey, if I just persevere, if I just sacrifice, like Jessica mentioned earlier, Ms. Homer, that if I sacrifice, ultimately I'll become a lawyer. You know, she has a Juris Doctorate degree. You know, what an amazing story. So she decided, I'm going to eat these peanut butter and jelly sandwiches because I got to get through, because I'm looking at the big picture down the road. And so I think that was a perfect example of making a decision to sacrifice something in the immediate present time for a long-term goal that you've set for yourself. So thank you. Next slide, please. The next category was availability of a strong support person. The statement it reads, I find it's easy to share my plans for the future. So I often talk with my teachers, instructors, and or supervisors about my plans, whether related to college or career aspirations. And so oftentimes, young people feel intimidated, especially college students. They don't like to go and talk to their professors, you know, to get to know them so that, you know, if you're struggling in an area, you can have that relationship and that rapport. We're often trying to encourage students to talk to your professors if you do find that there's a challenge or a situation. And for the young people, the students who are on today, you know, you seem very resilient, but I just want to encourage you to make sure you continue to have those conversations with people who can help you, whether they're your instructors or just mentors, individuals affiliated with FutureMakers, TRIO, what have you. We're here for you. And so being able to develop your network, and that means being open and talking to people and stepping out. And so if you strongly agree with this, then you're likely very resilient in this particular area. Next slide, please. The next one is successful leadership experience. The question statement says, I enjoy going with the flow. I will go along with whatever the group likes to do. So we have those people who don't like to rock the boat. They don't really like to put themselves out there. But they're, when you're doing that, are you really being a leader? Okay, I see my time is coming to a close. So I'm gonna keep going. Next slide, please. I mentioned I love to talk. Remember, I just love to chat. So I'm going to share my contact information as well. So if anybody wants to reach out to me to continue this conversation, I am so willing and open for that. Next slide, please. Okay, and the last section is the knowledge acquired in a field. I've talked about my career goals with someone who works in the position that I want in the future. I think this applies even beyond college. Even for ourselves right now, where you are in your current role, you may be interested 5-10 years down the road in doing something. So to start to have those conversations with people is so important in networking. And remember, the students in my study, they hadn't been doing that. They had very low scores in this area. So if you're working on your career or in college, I would say start talking with the people who have the position that you aspire to. Next slide, please. So overall, this is the score range. The lowest you could have made was an 8, and the highest was a 40. So you can gauge where your score was, if you're more resilient or if you have some areas that you need to work on. Maybe you need to start volunteering in the community to get your community service experience, find a mentor, build up the confidence to speak to people one-on-one about your plans and your goals. So maybe something that you could be working on in one of those 8 areas to kind of build up your resiliency score. Last slide, please. Now I'd just like to thank you all. If there's any last questions, I'm happy to answer them. But also, here's my contact information. You can reach me at FGCU at acorley at fgcu.edu. I have my personal email address here. I'm also on LinkedIn, Instagram as well. And please follow our TRIO Talent Search participants. They're amazing. That's FGCU_talent search. And so that is the end of my presentation, if there aren't any other questions. And thank you for your time. Thank you for listening to me about my story of resiliency. And hopefully, maybe I've inspired you in some way to just be mindful. Even though we're going through tough times right now, we have to stay focused on the long-term goal. The COVID-19 pandemic will end. I'm not sure if systemic racism is going to end overnight, but we're still fighting that fight. But let's not give up on ourselves and our personal goals and where we're trying to go. And let's try to maintain being resilient. Thank you so much for your time. And just remember, you can do it no matter how hard it gets.
Yay. Everyone, go ahead and give Dr. Corley a round of applause. You can do so by using your reactions like this, or you can visibly give her a round of applause. Thank you so much. I know, Dr. Corley, if you haven't seen the chat yet, you're going to be overjoyed. I see a lot about how much people have learned, particularly students. There are several students who receive scholarships from the Southwest Florida Community Foundation on here. So it's really, really cool to see. And also, there's a lot of students on here that are actually going to FGCU in the fall. So I think this was perfect.
Well, so come find me, whether email, or virtually, or when we can meet face to face. I look forward to meeting you all. Thank you.
So we have a lot more conversations like this coming up. I want to say that we do have an entire day-long session on structural racism and implicit bias. We are moving those virtually, so I'll be sure to send out that information as soon as those dates start opening up for you guys. We also have two more conversations that are similar to this one coming up, and I'm going to go ahead and drop those links in the chat for you. I'll also send an email out regarding these two equity and COVID-19 conversations that we have, and they're definitely applicable and will build on to what you learned from Dr. Corley today. So be on the lookout for future equity conversations, and they're definitely resume builders for my students. And when you go for those interviews for internships and jobs, you can definitely talk about the things that you've heard and learned today. So I'm also going to put a link in the chat regarding an evaluation. So we definitely listen to what we get as feedback on our evaluations. For instance, that August 6th equity and COVID-19 conversation is based off of feedback we received from evaluation. So please take a couple of moments and fill that evaluation out before we leave today. And that would be great. Let us know how we did, and then also let us know if there's any other future conversations you would be interested in. So yes, thank you so much, Dr. Corley. Since there's 2 minutes left, I want to make sure that if you can answer Sarah's question. She asked, what can you do if your family, environment, or disposition is negatively affected?
By COVID-19 or negatively affected by racism? I'm sorry, I'm trying to understand a little bit more.
Just kind of so I will be attending my first year of college this year and doing classes. And I do have a good family, good environment with friends, and I do have the motivation, I do have I've already found my dream house that I want. So I already have everything figured out. What can I do if, for example, something negative happens at home or something negative happens with my friends? What can I do in that situation?
In terms of negative and it's impacting your ability to continue in college, or you want to help the individuals in the situation?
Wanting to continue in college and being motivated to get up in the morning and attend class and take notes.
I would say definitely connect with the resources available at your institution. I know, for instance, at FGCU, there are so many amazing resources available for students. In that situation, there are students who may have to go back home. You want to communicate with your financial aid office. You want to communicate with your professors. You need to let them know what's going on. Sometimes people can make provisions or work it out with you so that you can meet those assignments and deadlines, even if something were to come up that pulled you away and you weren't able to complete assignments. So don't just shut down. I feel that students sometimes shut down and they don't move forward. Then we also have a counseling center on campus, and you may have one at your institution that's available. If things get hard, go and speak to a trained counselor, and also talk with your professors. Some of them have taken some training, and they know or will be able to help you connect with resources that you don't even know exist on your campus. But the first thing I would say is to speak up and let people know what's going on. Don't be afraid to tell them, hey, you know, something happened with my uncle, and now my mom is distracted, and I'm worried about her. I need to go home. I feel that something's going to happen. I had a student once who told me that her younger sibling was blaming her for, you know, going to college. She said, now that you're in college, dad is drinking too much and I can't handle it, you know? And so there was some abuse and things going on, and she was feeling pulled. And I was like, listen, we need to connect. Let me walk you over here, you know? And I was her instructor, you know, but I knew that I wasn't trained to have that conversation, but I got her to the right individuals. And they supported her, and she was brilliant, very bright student. And she was able to continue. So again, just speaking up, and I would say to educators, make yourself available where students feel comfortable to come to you and talk to you, and they know that you care about their success. I think that makes the difference as well. And so I always try to pride myself on being one of those individuals who's available. Just sometimes it's just knowing that someone is there. You might not need me today, but you may email me 3 years from now and say, hey, do you remember me? And I'm going to remember you. So that's what I would suggest, Sarah, if something were to come up. But I know that you seem very positive, and you're a creator, and you're going to work through that. So just make sure you stay connected with people who can help you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Good luck, too.
All right, everyone. Well, that is our time. Thank you, Dr. Corley, again for joining us today and being our special presenter. And we look forward to working together in the future.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. And I hope to continue to support FutureMakers. It's an outstanding organization, and keep up the great work. Thank you.
Yay. I'll see everyone soon. Okay, bye.